build a study with that DML Linac that was developed and exactly and is now being commercialized by a company called Elekta. And we also received research support from both Elekta and Philips, plus a few funding sources. And most of all, I also want to acknowledge the team of the Resolve Grant. Most of the work that I'll be showing today is actually the work of the postdocs and the PhD students mentioned here. All right, so my intro is going to be a little bit comparable to Elena. So cancer is the second leading cause of death globally. In 2018 alone, an estimated 9.6 million people will die of cancer. And as already mentioned, we have three major treatments available to us, depending on the stage of the disease. So the first one is surgery, chemotherapy, including other drug therapy like hormone or immunotherapy, and radiotherapy. And an estimated 50% of all patients will receive radiotherapy at some stage during their illness. So as you can already see from this picture, radiotherapy, like the other therapies mentioned just now, is very technologically driven. So we treat a patient with ionizing radiation, which we generate with a linear accelerator, and also image guidance is a real important issue or thing in radiotherapy. So even though radiotherapy has always been very CT guided, MR is really coming to play. So for the last two decades, the use of MRI has really increased. And if you just look at our department itself as an example, you see our department in Utrecht with all the treatment facilities. On the ground level here. And annually we treat about 5,000 new patients per year. So if you look at the map here, we treat those patients on 10 different treatment devices. Shown in black over here. And we have one CT simulator in purple over here. So the CT simulator is actually a preparatory imaging that we do where we treat, where we image the patients in our treatment position. And based on this reference image, we design our treatment plan. In contrast to a single CT, we now have five different MR scanners. So two MR simulators that are also used for pre-treatment imaging, a brachytherapy suite, a high-speed suite, and also two MR Linac systems. So the MR Linac system is going to be obviously the topic of this talk, so let's look a little bit closer to that system. In this space, the MR Linac system that we've developed in Utrecht is a 1.5 Tesla scanner based on the Ingenia platform by Philips. But if you take away the covers, you see that behind the covers there's a large ring-shaped gantry which mounts a linear accelerator of 7 MT. Located here, pointing towards the isocenter of the scanner. In order to allow radiation window with relatively little attenuation, we have a split gradient design with corresponding specs, and also the coils that we use are especially dedicated for this system, as they have to be radio resistant as well. So the whole development has been a very long trajectory. So we've been talking about from innovation to implementation. In our case, this took about 18 years. Starting from the invention in 2000, and the first few years actually involving a lot of lobbying to get the industry on board and actually start building designs and prototypes. And as we went along, it turned out that this wasn't a silly idea. Other groups also jumped on, each with various different designs, and you'll hear more about the Australian MR Linac in the talk later. So having gone through three different prototypes, we treated our first patients on a preclinical prototype in 2017, and this ultimately culminated in CE marking earlier this year. So far, along with three other sites, we've been treating patients now clinically, and all sites went live over the last 2 months. So, exciting times at the moment, and we're actually starting to use this really clinically right now. So, the rationale behind MR-guided radiotherapy, I think, is simple. So, this is showing you the conventional way we're doing this right now on the combi CT-guided Linac. So this is a Linac here with the cognitive CT sitting actually on sort of like a C arm. And this is the type of imaging that it presents as. And I think it's the most of the audience, it's pretty hard to tell what kind of tumor we're actually radiating. So this is great to align the patient, set up treatment plan on the bony anatomy, but not so great to actually guide on the tumor. So, you know, if we had this type of imaging to our disposal, we can really reduce those safety margins that Henry was talking about earlier on. However, just visualization on an individual basis is not the only thing that the hemolytic is going to bring us. It's also completely going to overhaul the workflow that we're currently using in radiotherapy. And just to talk you through what we're conventionally doing, I already mentioned the Tijssen. So the Tijssen is acquired to get a reference image, which we're going to treat for the rest of the fracture and treatment later on. So in week one, what we do based on that reference image, the physician contours the target, but also the organs at risk, the organs that we want to avoid with the radiation. Plus, the treatment plan is generated. And this involves a lot of manual steps, so it usually takes a couple of days. And then, once the treatment starts, we usually give the treatment in a series of fractionated treatment sessions. We just hope that the patient doesn't change too much because we only are doing one static treatment plan. In the hemolytic, however, we basically move from the conventional situation where we move the patient to suit that static treatment plan to adjust the treatment plan on a day-by-day basis to suit the patient. And this is actually a necessity because in the MRI, as everybody knows, we don't really have that movement to move the table around to actually put the patient in the right place. So we're actually forced to generate a new treatment plan every day. So this is sort of what the workflow looks like. And so a lot of the work that was originally done in week one now shifts to a day-by-day basis. So we acquire an image, we contour based on that daily anatomy, and then we generate an automated treatment plan on that day before we just irradiate that treatment. So if you look at the hemolytic from an imaging perspective, what are the challenges that we have here? We have challenges because, like so with every hybrid system, and in our case, this is, for example, the hardware. So we have modified receiver coils, and we have the split gradient array. But also the workflow is different. We have a real interactive interventional workflow, so the way that we deal with the images is different than what we're used to in the diagnostic setting. Also, we have a requirement for 3D imaging because we cannot see the radiation on the images itself. We need to have the full 3D volume to calculate the attenuation of our beam and to calculate how much dose we actually deposited in the tumor. And then finally, if we want to do motion tracking, like in abdominal organs, we need real-time tumor tracking. In our case, real-time is really real-time and not just high-temporal resolution. So our purpose is focusing on each of these things, starting with the coil. As in the picture above, you see the conventional coil, which is a four-channel interior array hovering above the patient, not to deform the body. And while this coil, along with the posterior coil, is great in just producing normal anatomical images, you can all imagine that for 2x4 channels is not really going to bring you far in terms of real-time imaging with high parallel imaging techniques. So what we're doing, and you've seen these images before, is that we're designing a radiolucent coil array with dense with many channels. And for this, the high-impedance coil array is actually very suitable as it doesn't contain any lumped elements in our radiation window shown in white here. We've done some dosimetry experiments there, and this proves to be a very suitable coil. And the additional advantage here, as we've heard this morning, is also that it's very flexible, so we can really wrap it around the patient to make ultimate use of the SNR. Alright, moving on to the imaging part. I'm just going to split this up into two sections. The first one is the preparatory imaging, or what we call premium imaging. And later on, I'm going to give you an example of real time imaging. So, if we focus on this preparatory imaging first, let's have a look at the workflow again. This is what we're currently doing clinically. So, first we take a high resolution 3D image. This takes about 5 minutes. And then this image is registered to the imaging we took from before or the day before in order to propagated quantums that we had onto our daily anatomy. And then based on this daily anatomy, an automated treatment plan is generated. Again, taking a few more minutes to complete. And because this all has taken some time, we require a secondary test to make sure that the patient hasn't moved in between. So here we can see three things. The first one is that the conventional diagnostic way of scanning, that sequential scanning, is slow. And there's also idle time in the workflow because of this. The second thing is that we stopped imaging during contouring and planning. And that's actually really silly to do because you have the patient on the scanner, so why not use that time to get some useful information in that time? So the first question we pose ourselves, can we fill a gap with something useful? And the obvious thing here is to design some imaging sequences that continue response monitoring. So apart from the obvious one like DWI, we also looked at MR fingerprinting. So here we tried just before you guys some RAM by last year to get MRF working on the MR link. So the acquisition we used here was a 3D golden angle fish sequence. We did some data corrections based on those measurements to account for the different gradient dynamics of our split gradient coil. And we used a dictionary which included P1, T2, and P1 plus size profile using Excel and phase graphs. And then finally, reconstruction involves the low right back projection. So we imaged a neurosperm sample which contains files of different T1 and no T1 and T2 values. The column that you see here is our gold standard fully relaxed T1 and T2 mapping method. Our MRF method without any acceleration, so that can create 5 minutes. If you look at the accelerated method, you see that the reconstructions look very similar. And if you look at the quantitative results, these graphs are plotting the MRF in the vertical axis. And our gold standard sequence horizontally, which we get for both T1 and T2 quantitation. This lies very nicely along the identity times line. It's a little bit noisier for T2, but that was expected. So we also tried this in T-Zar, so here's the three examples, one in the brain with a sequence of 6.5 seconds, and one in breath for all some abdominal scans. And I have to say, these data really assessed it qualitatively, so we still have to do the validation. But this is really nice evidence that it appears that MRF is actually possible on the MR link. And then going back to the workflow, second question we posed ourselves, can we perform smarter imaging to get rid of this idle time? Like what I see right now in clinic as well, like the first 5 minutes, everybody in the console room is actually just waiting. And talking about the weekend, can we actually make sure that the workflow is increased? So what we propose here is instead of that sequential way of imaging, have a continuous acquisition running, and while that acquisition running is running, get a continuous stream of new information to the user. So things that we, for example, after 2 seconds, you can already get a course overview of the daily anatomy and already start the registrations to go pre-beam imaging. After a minute, maybe contouring can start, starting with coarser organs. And then while the physician is contouring, an update, a higher resolution update is coming in to also delineate the smaller structures like your target. And then finally, if enough data has come in, create 4D MRIs to where we can reconstruct the images to different respiratory phases to get a feel for the amount of motion in that patient. So the sequence that we've designed here is a continuous golden angle second star sequence, and we continuously acquire that data during sleep breathing. And then basically, the sequence consists of 2 sections. The first one is what we call the growing resolution. So when we still have very little data in, we only take the center of case space to produce very low resolution images, but those images are still stable for us, for example, the registration. As more data is coming in, we can grow this disk in plane, not violate the Nyquist criteria, and generate higher resolution images. And by the time that we get our fully sampled image, we just continue our acquisition, basically over-sampling, but while we're overstamping, we have auto-adaptive self-taking installed, which downscales the spokes that are acquired at the extreme respiratory position. So ultimately, this just affects the deblurring of the motion. So this is what the sequence looks like on the hemodynamic. So you see here, we start at a very close resolution, and we go all the way up to 1.5 millimeters in this case. And then after that 1.5 millimeters is reached, you see slowly this motion blur disappearing. So a little bit slow, but at just that time, the position is just contouring the structures and the new images are coming in one at a time. And at the time that you've reached that mid-position, that sharpened image, the image is ready to go into the treatment management system. All right, moving on to real-time imaging then, so the imaging during B-roll. Here, the time scale in which we have to work is really sub-second, so we need to have our image within seconds or 100 milliseconds, but also the latency has to be very short. So this prevents us from using any compressed sensing technique, for example. So one thing we need to do is to go from single slides to the imaging. We want to increase the coverage here. And an obvious one we have to use is simultaneous multi-slice and multi-band. And looking back to the literature, we came across this paper. It didn't get a lot of attention when it was first published, but I think for our application, it's a very nice method, basically just because of its simplicity. So this is showing you two columns, Cartesian version and a radial version with 0-pi phase cycling. And what you see here is that when you 0-pi phase cycle one slide, and you just do the reconstruction without doing anything, the second slide is actually destructive interference, so you only produce slice number one. And by just doing a simple multiplication of the conjugate phase, you're able to reconstruct slice number two. So the advantages here are that it's very deep contextually, we don't need any coil sensitivity map, and it allows very high flexibility in terms of frame rate and sliding window reconstruction that we can use. So we've implemented this now on the scanner instead of the Windows 2.0 framework, and these are the type of images that we're getting out without any acceleration performed. But the nice thing is once you have this data, you can always go offline and do a compressed sensing reconstruction system. For example, you're interested in the cardiac motor later. And I apologize for the window 11 settings here, and also the gradient linearities are not corrected, but this is very preliminary. We only got this last week, so, but I thought it was nice to show you. Alright, so we have multi-sized imaging, but ideally we want to go to 3D, because like if you only have one 3D imaging, it can look more romantic than the reality actually is. And I think this is a nice picture demonstrating that. The more clinical example would be that in the 2D slice, it can be perfectly tracking, for example, a pancreas, but if right next to that slice is the duodenum, and we're radiating right through that, then we still have a big problem. So the holy grail here is to really go to 3D with high temporal resolution. So the way we did that a couple of years ago is to basically look at motion models. So what we do here is we have our incoming 2D images, so in this case we have an interleaved acquisition of coronal and sagittal slices. And in order to fill in the missing gaps here, we use our prior information that we obtained during premium imaging. So I just mentioned the 4D MRI acquisition. If we take that 4D MRI acquisition and reduce the dimensionality using a simple PCA analysis, we can basically warp our reference image to the incoming 3D images using this motion model. So this generates synthetic 3D imaging. So we've combined this now with our dose engine, and this allows us to really see where the dose is deposited while we have motion going on. And this is really for the first time that we're able to see this kind of thing, because on the Coleman fatigue system, where the imaging is too slow and also dependent on the angle that you're radiating, since imaging is not possible. So the machines are going to produce a lot of data, and this is kind of like where it links to the deep learning talk earlier today. was a huge amount of data, and we could use that amount of data to learn from it, right? So within the consortium, which now consists of 7 members worldwide, plus an additional 12 early members, we're setting up a large database, which is called the Momentum Database, and it's meant to provide us as a prospective cohort study. So we try to really evaluate the outcome of the analytics, so to really assess the clinical value of this new technology. And this is a screenshot of the database. The data that's going in there includes patient data, so age, disease state, biomarkers, etc., but also all the technical data, things like baseline data, quarantine, MRI sim. Response monitoring, for example, requires every single treatment session of the MRI, but also the radiotherapy plan, the distribution of vector seals. So, per patient, you're able to play back the entire treatment with the idea. And I think that's going to be very powerful. So, in summary, I think the MRI is not only going to provide us detailed imaging to better guide the treatments of individual patients, but it's also going to allow us a new window into what we're actually doing. So with these tools like dose accumulation mapping in combination with tumor characterization and imaging at every single treatment session, hopefully this is going to show us at a pixel by pixel level what the radiation is actually doing on a biological level. And I think this is really exciting and will give us more insights and hopefully bring new research. So with that, I'd like to thank my collaborators and thank you for listening.